بسم الله الرحمن الرحیم. السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ. ڈیئر اسٹوڈنٹس، دس از اے اسکرین کاسٹ فار ہسٹوپیتھولوجی پریکٹیکل سیشنس، لیبارٹری سیشنس فار انڈوکرائن سسٹم ماڈیول. سو لیٹ اس گو ان ٹو دا ورک بک. So these are the specimens, grass specimens we discussed in the lab, especially the Graves disease, Hashimoto thyroiditis, and we discussed by using the case scenarios, the pheochromocytoma and the neuroblastoma, and we discussed another two specimens apart from Graves disease and Hashimoto thyroiditis. We discussed about in the wet specimen, we discussed multinodular goiter, and we discussed a solitary nodule in the plastinated specimen, nodule in the plastinated specimen. So we don't have images of those specimens in the workshop, sorry, in the workbook. Actually this issue has been solved in the other batches because we are creating the printed books for them. So please bear with us, and but during the lab session we allowed the students to take photograph of the specimens which we described and which we explained to you guys, using the two different types of specimens, as you guys know about it, plastinated and formulated specimens. So totally four specimens, okay, especially all in the thyroid. So what are they? The diffuse thyroid goiter, and that is related to the Graves disease, and another specimen is a multinodular goiter, and it is the wet specimen we showed, that is with formulated specimen. Another specimen is asymmetrical swelling multinodular goiter, but cut section is like solid tan appearance, and that is Hashimoto thyroiditis. So another specimen that is also this is also plastinated specimen. Another specimen which we showed you and demonstrated that is a solitary nodule in the thyroid, and I showed you how it compressing the normal thyroid area, all those stuffs, and that so that is a follicular adenoma fatigue, but it's a solitary nodule follicular adenoma. So these are the specimens we described, and these specimens we don't have photograph for in the practical book. So please we allow the students to take the photograph. Please use those photographs, and the specimens can be asked in the exam. So then apart from that, we discussed some static standardized images for the gross specimen discussion, and then we used the whole slide imaging technology, that is the real slides which we scan by using a digital scanner, and that is a latest technology we use to see the microscopic slides. So those things which we discussed are pituitary adenoma and adenomatous hyperplasia of thyroid, toxic goiter, Hashimoto thyroiditis, and papillary carcinoma of thyroid and medullary carcinoma of thyroid. So apart from that, we discussed five cases, very important cases. Inshallah, the same thing which we are going to screencast now. Now going to the microscopic specimen, So after the macroscopic means gross specimen discussion. So after this gross specimen discussion, inshallah, after this, I expect you people to describe the specimens by yourself and find the characteristic findings of certain diseases in those specimens, and you can illustrate the findings and you can list the findings. These are the things we expect you guys to do. Like, you can demonstrate, like how we demonstrated. These are the things which we really expect you guys to do. So that is our intention, that is our intended learning outcome. So let us go to the first pituitary gland pathology. And see, whenever you discuss about the laboratory part of the histopathology sessions, and you have to previously, you should have a prerequisite is you should have a previously pre you should have a any like lecture with the lecture knowledge. It will help you a lot to understand the laboratory part. So I su suggest here, before you study the pituitary gland pathology, the organ pathology, you should go back, if you didn't go, and go back and study the lectures which we discussed in the theoretical part. Okay, so now let us go into the laboratory sessions which we discussed about pituitary gland pathology. So this is the hemisection of the brain, and what you are going to see here, see, concentrate on this area. This is a small nodule which expand the pituitary. Okay, a nodule which expands the pituitary gland, and this is the So this nodule is the one small nodule, okay, and it is slightly comprising the surrounding area, okay. So this is the pituitary adenoma, okay. And if this usually produce mass effect lesions if the adenoma is very big like this, okay. So here you see there is a big adenoma, okay, very large adenoma, maybe of around any like nearly 6 by 4 centimeter, and see it, you can see the compression of the surrounding brain. Okay, inshallah, what are the parts of the brain it is compressing and what are the symptoms it is producing? Inshallah, we will again discuss more in detail about the cellular tumors in the CNS. Now, you please understand that because this area, this pituitary, is located in a critical position, that it is surrounded by the area which are all involved in the vision. So, it produces characteristically visual disturbances. So the mostly the visual problems are characteristic when they so because they press the optic chiasma, and they produce severe headache and like due to intracranial pressure along with nausea, vomiting. So these are the characteristic symptoms in this case. It will produce like visual disturbances like bitemporal hemianopsia. And like so I better I will explain it here. By temporal hemianopsia, and they also produce raised intracranial pressure that will reflect as headache, vomiting, nausea, and vomiting. So when we have this characteristic symptoms, we generally expect some problem in the cranium, and if you do a scan of MRI, See your you will see a expansion in the cellular region, and you can able to to a conclusion that there is a massive expansion which is compressing the visual areas involved in the brain, involved in the visual areas, and it produce this kind of symptoms, and you can come to a conclusion we are dealing with the pituitary adenoma. This is one kind of problem the pituitary adenoma produce. So another kind of problem is within the pituitary adenoma, that is a pituitary adenoma, even it may be a smaller one like this and a larger one like this, they can produce their hormones. Okay, so they produce hormones, so then it makes them into functional pituitary adenomas, and what type of hormones they produce, according to that they produce the effect. So this is the thing you should keep in your mind. And another problem actually we encounter is sometimes, okay, the pituitary adenomas they will not produce any hormone. Okay, so for example, consider this is the pituitary adenoma, very large pituitary adenoma, actually destroyed the normal pituitary gland. So it is full of adenoma, and if there is no hormone production by this adenoma, what will happen? They will end up with severe hypopituitarism. And they will produce severe hypopituitary symptoms, which we discussed in the lecture sessions. So this is about pituitary adenoma. So now you all know that actually the pituitary adenoma, let us little bit zoom in. Okay, now you all know that pituitary adenoma, pituitary gland is well connected with hypothalamus, right? So if there is any problem in the hypothalamus, okay, what happens is the posterior pituitary is affected more. So this is a tumor which comes in the hypothalamus. So you can see a very large tumor, and it is cystic tumor, and it is literally destroying the hypothalamus. This will seriously results in decreased production of ADH and oxytocin. So they will seriously produce a complex disease called diabetes insipidus, and this will leads to destruction of, sometimes massively it can destruct the whole pituitary also if it is going to expand massively. So these are the problems we encounter in a tumor which comes in the hypothalamus. It is called craniopharyngioma. And remember, or any other tumor surrounding the hypothalamus, okay, so they can come and compress the hypothalamus, and they can produce the same effect of reduction in the ADH. So this is another problem we encounter. So this you should keep in your mind, anything damages the hypothalamus, it will result in massive reduction in the ADH. So that results in diabetic insipidus. So now let us go to the thyroid gland. Okay, so it is the thyroid gland, and it's not the normal. But it maintains its more or less it maintains its normal shape because it has two lobes, two lateral lobes, and a isthmus. You can see some connection, okay, but it is bizarre looking, But still, they try to maintain the shape of the thyroid gland. So, because you can still put a lobe and the isthmus. And but what you are seeing here is it's a full, you can appreciate nodules of different size, right? It is not a homogeneous looking thyroid, it is all any like nodules of varying size. It is involving the isthmus, and there is a, you can see a huge nodule here, right? There's a huge nodule, and within the nodule also there you can see some septa running, and it is making some lobules kind of pattern. So this is when you see, okay, so this is called multinodular goiter, okay. So we cannot come to a definite diagnosis unless we take a section from this side. We will take a section here and we see under the microscope, and we will come to a conclusion whether it is a hyperplastic multinodular goiter or whether it is showing some kind of inflammation. So like that we will try to come to a conclusion. So this areas has to be seen under the microscope, okay. So otherwise you can also relate with the hormone profiles. For example, this goiter is producing reduction in the T3 T4 type. So the what happens is it is a hypothyroid state, and also relate with the clinical feature. Okay, the patient in hypothyroid state, if it is a female, they have menstrual abnormalities as well as they have a lot of like intolerance to cold, they become lazy and so very dull looking, so they sleep for a longer period. So this kind of unusual disturbances in their physical activities. So you, when you encounter such things, so and they will have, they increase their weight, okay. So and slowly mental slugginess, so this all the things you will encounter, and on the so you will be suspecting hypothyroidism, and the hormone profile also shows this evidence of hypothyroidism. Then you examine, you are examining the thyroid, and it is showing enlarged thyroid, and you are feeling a multinodularity, but there should not be any fixed thyroid. It should move with deglutition, and because of the large thyroid swelling, it can produce compression effects like difficulty in swallowing. So this kind of things it can produce. So you should, so because of the symptomatic problem, and they would have removed her this thyroid. If it is the situation and it is showing only hyperplasia of the follicles in microscopy, then we will come to a conclusion, diffuse hyperplastic thyroid, there is some problem in the hormone synthesis. It may be due to some goitrogenic effect, or maybe due to some inherited effect of synthesis of hormone. So like that we'll discuss, and we'll come to a conclusion of hyperplastic adenomatous goiter. So this is how we arrive to a diagnosis. So it is a, it is an integrated diagnosis in thyroid diseases. It's not like individual diagnosis. So what we discussed here is like it's a multiple nodules of varying sizes and throughout the thyroid gland, and there are some areas of bleeding spots here, like areas of hemorrhage and fibrosis are seen, and the nodules that develop in a multinodular goiter probably due to facts of some follicular cells are inherently more responsive to the TSH. Actually this part we explained more in detail in the lecture sessions as well as in the lecture screencast. Okay, you can refer to that. So please in case you have any doubt in these areas, it is well explained in the lecture screencast as well as in the during the lecture time, so please refer to them. Now we are going to the other grass.